Hello, everyone. Good to see you all and trust that you've had a great week. Welcome to our service at Church on the Rise, Beaufort in Ebbw Vale. And we pray that God will truly bless each one of you. Thank you for joining us this evening. We're going straight into our first song, and we're going to join in together as we sing together. And so I'm just going to put it up on the screen now in a second, and we'll sing Our God is Greater. What a declaration that is. Praise his name.
Higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome and powerful.
We have a great God, God of power. He has awesome power. And he can be your healer this evening, as we've just sung. Praise his name. Now we're going to have a reading from Anwen. So over to you, Anwen.
The reading is taken from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Now when he saw the crowds, he went up onto a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." Amen.
Thank you, Anwen, for that lovely word. And we do pray that as we look at that word a little later, that God will speak to our hearts. Now I'm going to ask Lana to pray for us. So over to you, Lana. Thank you.
Father, we just want to thank you that we can meet together. And Lord, as you say, we are blessed, Lord. And Father, we just want to pray that the words on that scripture, Lord Jesus, will highlight the things that we need to hear about blessings, about when we are blessed. And Lord, I just want to thank you. And I just want to sometimes just get up in the morning and say, I will thank you, Lord Jesus. And that I come into your courts with thanksgiving in my heart, because I'm blessed, Lord Jesus, with a just looking at the snow, being warm, and knowing, Lord Jesus, that you are with us. Wherever we go, we are blessed because you are with us. And I just pray that everybody who listens now will hear what it means to be blessed. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Lana. Good to pray blessing upon each one of us. And it's good to know that God wants to pour his blessings upon us. We thank him that he is
the God
who blesses his people. So I'm going to hand over to Gary now as he shares from God's word. Thank you, Gary.
Thank you, Wayne. Well, good evening, everyone. It's good to be with you. And I wanted to look at an introduction to the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew chapters 5 to 7 gives us a full introduction, but we're only doing 3 verses of it today. The previous chapter, chapter 4, Matthew verse 25, mentioned that great multitudes followed Jesus, coming from many different regions. In response to this, Jesus went up on a mountain where he sat down and began teaching the disciples and the multitude. And Spurgeon says that Jesus began to speak to them with freedom, so as the multitude might hear. Jesus Christ spoke like a man in earnest. He talked clearly and spoke loudly. He lifted up his voice like a trumpet and published salvation far and wide, like a man who had something to say, which he desired his audience to hear and feel. Many commentators believe that the Sermon on the Mount was Jesus' standard sermon, the core of his itinerant message, a simple proclamation of how God expects us to live. It may be that when Jesus preached to new audiences, he often preached themes from this sermon. What they heard was a message that has long been recognized as the sum of Jesus's ethical teaching. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus tells us how to live a godly life. Matthew shows us Jesus instructing his disciples in his message, which they were to share with others. Likewise, Christians are expected to share this same message with others. It's the gospel message. This sermon is often thought of as Jesus' declaration of the kingdom. We know that the American revolutionaries had their Declaration of Independence, and Karl Marx had his Communist Manifesto. But with this message, Jesus declared what his kingdom is all about. The first portion of the sermon is known as the Beatitudes, which means the blessings, but can also be understood as giving the believer be attitudes, that is, the attitudes he or she should display. In the Beatitudes, Jesus sets forth both the nature and aspirations of citizens of his kingdom. They have and are learning these character traits. In verse 3, Jesus said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Blessed. Jesus promised blessing to his disciples, promising that the poor in spirit are blessed. The idea behind the Greek word for blessed is happy, but in the truest godly sense of the word, not in our modern sense of merely being comfortable or entertained. In Matthew 25, verse 34, Jesus said that on the day of judgment, he would say to his people, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." On that day, he will judge between the blessed and the cursed. He both knows and explains the requirements for the blessed one. Spurgeon pointed out that he's sure that we have not failed to notice that the last word in the Old Testament is curse. And it is suggested that the opening sermon of our Lord's ministry commences with the word blessed. Note also with delight that the blessing is in every case in the present tense. A happiness to be now enjoyed and delighted in. It is not blessed shall be, but blessed are the poor in spirit. The poor in spirit recognize that they have no spiritual assets. In fact, they are spiritually bankrupt. We might say that the Greek had a word for the working poor and a different word for the truly poor. Jesus used the word for the truly poor here. It indicates someone who might beg for what they have or get. Poverty of spirit cannot be artificially induced by self-hatred. The Holy Spirit and our response to his working in our hearts brings it about. This beatitude is first, said Spurgeon, because this is where we start with God. A ladder, if it is to be of any use, must have its first step near the ground, or feeble climbers will never be able to mount. It would have been a grievous discouragement to struggling faith if the first blessing had been given to the pure in heart. To that excellence, the young beginner makes no claim, while to poverty of spirit, he can reach without going beyond his line. Everyone can start at this point. It isn't first, blessed are the pure, or the holy, or the spiritual, or the wonderful. Everyone and anyone can be poor in spirit. Not what I have, but what I have not, is the first point of contact between my soul and God. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Those who are poor in spirit, so poor they have to beg, are rewarded. They receive the kingdom of heaven, because poverty of spirit is an absolute prerequisite for receiving the kingdom of heaven. And as long as we harbor illusions about our own spiritual resources, we will never receive from God what we absolutely need to be saved. The kingdom of heaven is not given on the basis of race, earned merits, or the wealth of a rich person. It's given to the poor, the despised, the publicans, the prostitutes, those who are so poor, they know they can offer nothing and do not try. They cry for mercy, and they alone are heard, because God hears our cries for mercy. Jesus came to bless us and save us. Spurgeon also said on this that the poor in spirit are lifted from the dunghill and set not among hired servants in the field, but among princes in the kingdom. Poor in spirit, the word sounds as if they describe the owners of nothing. And yet they describe the inheritors of all things. Millionaires sink into insignificance. The treasure of the Indies evaporate in smoke, while to the poor in spirit remains a boundless, endless, faultless kingdom, which renders them blessed in the esteem of him who is God over all, blessed forever. You're a wonderful speaker, Spurgeon. The call to be poor in spirit is placed first for a reason, because it puts the following commands into perspective. They cannot be fulfilled by one's own strength, but only by a person's reliance on God's power. No one mourns until they are poor in spirit. No one is meek towards others until he has a humble view of himself. If we don't sense our own need and poverty, we will never hunger and thirst after righteousness. And if we have too high a view of ourselves, we will find it difficult to be merciful to others. Verse 4, Matthew says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." Jesus doesn't speak of casual sorrow for the consequences of our sin, but a deep grief before God over our fallen state. "For they shall be comforted." Those who mourn over their sin and their sinful condition are promised comfort. God allows this grief into our lives as a path, not as a destination. Those who mourn can know something special of God, the fellowship of his sufferings, he says in Philippians 3, verse 10, a closeness to the man of sorrows who was acquainted with grief, he says in Isaiah 53, verse 3. Verse 5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Again, in the Greek language, the meek person was not passive or easily pushed around. The main idea behind the word meek was strength under control, like a strong stallion that was trained to do the job instead of running wild. To be meek towards others implies freedom from malice and a vengeful spirit. Those suffer wrong without bitterness or desire for revenge. In fact, they could be seen as gentle giants. The first two Beatitudes are mostly inward. The third deals with how one relates to one's fellow man. The first two were mainly negative, and the third is clearly positive. To be meek is to show willingness to submit and work under proper authority. It also shows a willingness to disregard one's own rights and privileges. It is one thing for me to admit my own spiritual bankruptcy, but what if someone else does it for me? Do I react meekly? This blessed one is meek. They are meek before God in that they submit to his will and conform to his word. They are meek before men in that they are strong, yet also humble, gentle, patient, and long-suffering. For they shall inherit the earth. We can only be meek, willing to control our desire for our rights and privileges, because we are confident God watches out for us and that he will protect our cause. As we heard last week, cover us with his panoply. The promise, they shall inherit the earth, proves that God will not allow his meek ones to end up holding the short straw. It looked as if they would be pushed out of the world, but they shall not be, for they shall inherit the earth. The wolves devour the sheep, yet there are more sheep in the world than there are wolves, and the sheep continue to multiply and feed on green grass. We have only to look upon it, all as the sun shines upon it, and then to look up to heaven and say, my Father, this is all yours, and therefore it is all mine. For I am an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus. So in this sense, the meek-spirited man inherits the whole. Though the first three Beatitudes, we notice that the natural man finds no happiness or blessedness in spiritual poverty, mourning, or meekness. These are only a blessing for the spiritual man. Those who are new creations in Jesus. Earlier in Jesus' ministry, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there and his disciples, and Jesus were also invited. When the wine was gone, Mary said to Jesus, they have no more wine. He answered, why do you involve me? My hour has not yet come. But his mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Jesus told them to take 6 large stone water jars, each of which held 20 to 30 gallons. Fill them with water, which they did. Then he told them, now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet. They did this. The master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He didn't realize where it came from, though the servants knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." This was the first of the signs through which Jesus revealed his glory. Mary told the servants to do whatever Jesus tells you. And Jesus told his followers to share this gospel with others. Have you given your heart to Jesus, my friend? Do you know how much he loves you? He gave his life for you and for me and all of our sins. Nothing can wash away our sins. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. He rose from the dead where he defeated the enemy of our soul to ensure that meek people like us will inherit the kingdom of heaven. Will you make that decision today, my friends? He's calling you right now. Come to him today. Come, and you too will be able to inherit the kingdom of heaven. For his name's sake, amen.
Thank you, Gary, for sharing from God's word. So much in those first three Beatitudes. Perhaps it's another opportunity for us to listen to the message again on demand on our Facebook page and YouTube page. But if you have been challenged by that word and you want to respond, we'd love to pray with you. We'd love to share with you more. And so at the end of this video, there is some details how to contact us. And please do that. Please take this opportunity. It's an opportunity to know more about God and what he's got for you and for each one of us. So we praise him and we thank him. We're going to sing our final song now. It's a longer version because the shorter version is not available, apparently. But we're going to sing it. It talks about God being our waymaker, etc. So let's sing this together. And I wonder if Gareth can close in prayer for us this evening, please. So I'm just going to put it up on the screen and we'll sing it together. You are here.
You're the one. His name is above. His name is above depression.
Well, folks, there's some important words in that song. Let me remind you, he wants to touch your heart. He also wants to heal your heart. He also wants to turn your life around and mend your heart. So if you want to respond to that, then please do so. And please get in touch with us. We'd love to help you and pray with you. I'm going to ask Gareth now to close in prayer. So thank you for joining us this evening. Thank you, Gareth.
And Father, we do thank you for all the words that we've heard. We thank you for the words that we've sang, that you're a promise keeper, that you're a way maker, that you're a miracle worker. And your word tells us that you never change. So if we need you to be any of those things to us, we have the assurance that you will be. So as we go, we ask your blessing upon each of us, upon everybody that's heard it, and we do it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you for joining us tonight, folks. And we do pray God's blessing on you this week. And do join us again next weekend. So we can ask everyone to unmute themselves and say their farewells. And God bless you all.
God bless.
Bye. 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 Bye